As we wrap up another insightful episode of In the Know, remember that the journey to success is a collective effort. Share the wisdom, spread the... Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to In the Know, Life, the Law, and Legacy, your go-to destination for empowerment and enlightenment. This is a show designed with you in mind, targeting the young men in our community and those who champion their success. Get ready to be armed with knowledge that's not just powerful, but practical. It's time to navigate the currents of life with confidence, legality, and a legacy in the making. Now, here's your host, Attorney Mike Manning.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. I am so happy and so excited to be with you today for episode number 4, In the Know. I'm your host, Mike Manning, and you are listening to our show, and it's a show that's dedicated to the development of young men. Joining me today is two of very talented individuals that make the show possible. That would be my most talented wife, Kimberly Manning. Yay. And my right hand in law business, the talented Sansa Ray. How you doing, Sansa Ray?
Hey, now doing great.
All right. We are going to get right into the show. Today we're going to be talking about decision making. Mm. As a young person, you're going to be faced with many life-altering decisions. Today we're going to give you the GPS on how to get to the right choice. Okay?
Slap it on your hand.
How to get to the right choice. And the way we boil this down is that there are four questions that you should be sure to ask yourself whenever you're facing any major big decisions in your life. Four questions. It should always just be that easy, right, sons? Just got to ask myself four questions.
Agree. What about those small issues? Should they pertain to those also?
Well, who knows?
We'll see. Depends what it is.
All right.
What decision?
A special shout out to KBOB 89.9 FM and the man that makes this all possible, Mr. Bobby Eaton.
Whoop, whoop.
Yes, Bobby Eaton II. And we love the radio station. We're so happy that they allow us to do this. Thank you so much, Mr. Eaton.
Thank you, Bobby.
Yes, thank you, Bobby.
All right. So four questions to ask yourself before making any major decisions in life. Point number one. Well, before I begin, I'm going to put my co-host on the spot. I'm going to put him on the spot. Before today, I just want to ask you, taking a poll, before today, did you have a certain set of rules to evaluate a big life decision?
Well, in my case, I would say, depending on what the situation, if it's a big decision, how it's going to affect me and my family.
Okay.
I have a tendency to get ahead of myself, mm-hmm. so I have to really watch that. I have mm-hmm. to be in the here and now and then progressively think, well, what are the consequences if I don't do it? What are the consequences if I do it? And how is it going to affect me and those around me?
Okay. What about you, Kim?
I would say that I didn't have a set of principles that I went through every time I made a big decision. Mm-hmm. I kind All right. of just relied on my past experience and what I knew, even mm-hmm. if I didn't know that much about it. And I hate to say that because I didn't go and do the research as much as I probably do now. But I the short answer to your question would be no. But yes, there are a set of rules that are internal that I don't even think about when I make a decision.
You know, you guys, you probably sound like if I was to go out and poll or take a survey of everyone in America, I would get probably 95% of the population would give that kind of answer. And it's amazing to me that even I would have given this kind of answer until I've learned some of this stuff, is that we leave up to we leave so many major decisions in our life up to chance. Mm-hmm. Or should I say, here's a classic example of what happens. We say, you know, here are the choices. I'm thinking about it. Well, what are you thinking about? What questions are you asking yourself? For those of you all that know me, you know, probably know that I play a lot of different, well, I play two different games that require a lot of thinking. One is chess and the other one is poker. Now, in poker, there's a certain set of things you got to ask yourself before you make a decision. Whether you're going to raise, whether you're going to call, or whether you're going to fold your hand. And if you don't go through your list of questions, you will often make a big mistake. So we're going to give you four questions. We're going to give you four questions, and we're going to talk a little bit about each one of them as we go throughout the show on that you should be asking yourself in order to make good decisions whenever you have a big decision to make in your life. Let's get into it. Number one. One of the first questions you're going to ask yourself is, do I have all the options? Is there a third option? In a book I was taking a look at called Decisive, Chip and Dan Heath, the authors, warn us to beware of the binary. And as soon as I saw that, the binary, meaning that it's either this or that. Remember, y'all remember that song, you can get with this or you can get with that, right? You can get with this. Oh, man.
Yeah. Only two options.
Y'all folks don't know nothing about that. It reminded me of Congress, right? It reminded me of the state of our Congress, right? Beware of the binary. Binary just means two. So beware of the two choice things, because oftentimes there are more than two options. Do I have all the information? Do I have all of the options?
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the reasons why you want to take the time and get all your options is because when you finally make the decision, you can make it with confidence.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to get, just for an example, I wanted to get some custom suits made. I said, it's time, Mike. You got one arm shorter than the other. A lot of people don't know these things about themselves. I do. And you got this little hump thing that comes when you get suits out the rack, you know, and the suits and everything in my size. And it's time to get something that's, you know, kind of tailor-made. Why is that so funny?
It's funny to me because I'm like, what did I marry? You got a hump in his back.
It's the little thing.
The way that, it's that, made. You know, yeah.
Like the jacket. You can have a little. Men know what I'm talking about. But anyway. Anyway, so I started looking around.
Mm-hmm.
Well, y'all, tailor-made suits are pretty expensive, right?
I imagine.
I'm looking at cute clothier. Ooh, more than I want to pay for a suit. I was looking at going down here to Utica Square. For those of you all that in Radio Land don't know, it is real kind of exclusive shopping area, but they have a place where you can get tailor-made suits. And then I started just looking and researching online. I finally landed, after about five or six different experiences, on a place. I won't name the name. If you call me or you call in, we'll tell you, because they're not paying for any advertising, so I won't tell you exactly what it was. But I found a place that would measure you up. And I mean really measure you up. About 20 different measurements. They take the time to get it right. They put it into their system. You go pick the fabric. You pick the style. I mean, everything.
Wow.
From how you wear, you want your pockets and all, whatever. All that, the label, the insides of your jacket, the linings, all of that, the buttons. And then you order the suit, and it arrives in about a couple weeks. You can go into your local major department store. I won't name the name of that store either. And if you had any problems, they will fix it at that time. Well, I got two of these suits for the same price that I would pay to buy one off the rack. And then
shut the door.
In some case, cheaper.
Wow.
But that's because I took my time and looked through all the options, right?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever, Sansray, have you ever had a situation where you thought you had all the options, but you found out later after you had made a choice that there was another option.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yes, I have.
And
yes, I
have. How did that make you feel?
Like the saddest girl in the whole USA.
So we
because my first mind had told me, don't do it. Okay. Don't do it. Mm-hmm. But my desire was, oh, it's going to be fun. Everybody going to be up there. It's going to be fun. And I, like I said, when I left, gotcha. My head was hanging down. That wasn't a good decision.
Gotcha. Well, one thing that happens, like I said, when we don't look to see that we have all the options. Now, the other thing I want to tell you is don't get paralyzed by analysis either, though. You got to be careful with question number one. Is there a third option? Do I have all the options? Because some people will become paralyzed and frozen at question number one because they say, well, how do I know if I mm-hmm. have all the options, right?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever not moved on something because you wasn't sure? Right now, we've been looking for how long for Kimberly a car?
Well, I think that's a different scenario because I've decided what car I want. Mm-hmm. I just don't know when I want to get it. So I know what I want. I'm thinking about the end of the year. So
Well, let me ask you this. End of the year? All over again? So let me ask you this. How many cars did you look at before you realized this is the one I want?
Four, I believe.
Four different cars.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But before you went, you had already narrowed it down to I want an SUV, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Because you carry around the 15-year-old and sometimes some of her friends mm-hmm. and a bunch of stuff from the store and mm-hmm. all that kind of stuff. Okay. Mm-hmm. And did you know you want what, leather?
Yeah, I didn't want cloth. Okay. All right.
So you made a list. You made a list of the things that you wanted, and then you went out and sought for these options, mm-hmm. whatever options you have, right? Okay. Okay, so now you say you know what car it is. I'm writing this down because you say you know what car it is. You want to wait until the end of the year.
Right.
All right, yeah. Sounds good to me.
I might look at one more model, too.
Might look at one more make.
So you're not totally decided.
I don't have analysis paralysis, if that's what you want to get at. I don't.
don't have the analysis paralysis. All right. Very good. So, hey, let's move on to question number one. Question number two. Question number one, I want to ask, I want to make sure and ask, I just looked on my feed. Hey, Lisa out there and Cindy Freeman, all y'all good folks. Thank you for joining. So the first question is there a third option? The second question you should always ask yourself is this. What advice would I give a friend? What advice would I give a friend concerning this situation? I want to spend a little time here. You ask yourself, so why, if I'm confused and can't, you know, about the decision, why would I ask myself, what advice would I give a friend? Well, listen. When it's our issue, when it's our choice, when it's our decisions to be made, one of the things that we have to guard against is not seeing the forest for the trees. You know what I mean when I say that? Sometimes when we're so caught up in something, we can't see the big picture. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, our decision-making is clouded, mm-hmm. right? So if we remove ourselves and say, we're not even talking about me now. I'm talking about what if my friend came to me with this choice or decision, what would I tell them? And lo and behold, I know, Kim, you can attest to this, that have you ever seen somebody in a relationship and you know good and goddamn on well?
Right.
They ain't got no business
being together
in that relationship, mm-hmm. like the both of them, like oil and water and don't mix, mm-hmm. right? Why do you think that, there's various reasons. I don't want to get into all the particular reasons why somebody might stay and be in a relationship like that, but why do you think that they don't see that just as readily as you do?
Well, they have emotions tied up into it that mm-hmm. I wouldn't have looking mm-hmm. from the outside mm-hmm. in. And a lot of times you can make rash decisions, the wrong decisions, because you can't see all of the negative things about you staying in that relationship
uh-huh.
as clearly as if you didn't have that emotional attachment.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Right. I agree with you wholeheartedly. When you ask yourself, you know, what advice would I give my friend? Sansari, you wanted to say something?
Go ahead. No, I was just going to say I agree with that, because sometimes you're so deep in the situation that it's like even asking yourself that question, it's still a question, because you're so deep, especially in relationships, mm-hmm. because you're dealing with, like Kimberly said, you're dealing with these emotions. My emotions are one way, but what about his emotions? Mm-hmm. Are we clicking? Are we not? And then we're fighting, we're this, we're that. That still doesn't make you feel like making the right decision, because you're so wrapped up in love, or what you think is love.
Yeah. I couldn't agree any wholeheartedly with you. I think the thing of it is that there are things that's other than the objective things maybe that comes to play when you're involved. And like I said, it becomes, those things are the trees in the forest, mm-hmm. and you can't see the big picture. And so you should ask yourself, it's sort of a stepping back and saying, okay, what advice would I give a friend concerning this situation? Right. And I think, and I tried to separate these, but it kind of comes into play. And when you do that, you have to ask yourself this question too. It's a what else question, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's like, okay, what advice would I give a friend? And if I was giving my friend the advice, I'm going to be giving them my very best advice, right?
Right.
And if I'm giving them my very best advice, I've thought about the advice and then a sort of what else. So, for example, I'm sticking with this theme about bad relationships. If I'm going to tell my friend and say, look, you know, I know you love Herman, and maybe sometime later on you guys can, but right now you guys, all you do is, I mean, you fight. The police has been called out. I had a case this week where I had to take off my lawyer hat and put on my old man daddy hat, because I had an individual, and I'm not naming any names or anything like that. I had an individual who came to me about a relationship, a situation where he's got a protective order against her, she's got a protective order against them. Right away, I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. And she is now with child. Now, there's got to be a whole lot of, first of all, there's some dysfunction, but there's got to be a whole lot of things that if I were that her friend, I would advise her on this, that, or the other. And that's kind of what I did. But I'm asking myself, how come she can't see that this is not good for her? Right? This is not good for her. It wasn't the best choice.
Sometimes, though, we stay in, and I'm speaking from experience.
Okay.
Sometimes we stay in the situation, especially if you have children. And I'm speaking about, like I said, my past experience, fighting, abusiveness, mentally, physically. And I ended up staying in the situation for 9 years. I was very young. And I think that has a lot to do with it, too, is your age, because you don't have that mileage of knowledge. And I was young and I felt like I didn't have any way out. I was in a city with no relatives, 1,300 miles away from home. And if I had called home, all of San Diego would have been in Tulsa beating that person down. So I didn't want that. So
I didn't mean to cut you off.
Oh, that's okay.
But let me just go right here and tell you this. So knowing all that, though, still, what advice would you have given a friend? Would you told your friend to stay in that situation?
I would have told my friend, you know what? Our love is not good love, and that is not good love.
And you would have told your friend, what you telling me are excuses.
Mm-hmm.
That you feel are very good reasons to continue where you are right now. That's what you would have told a friend. See, you see what I'm mm-hmm. saying?
Yeah.
If your friend right. came to you and said, yeah, but my family's this far and all, you would say, baby, look, I'm right here. I'll help you through this.
Mm-hmm.
You don't, it's the last black eyes I want to see from you. That's mm-hmm. the last, you see what I'm mm-hmm. saying? So that's the reason why the question, what advice would you give a friend? Not what advice would you give yourself? Because sometimes it's sad to say, we are more thoughtful of our friends, other people than we are ourselves. That's we'll sit there and we'll take mess that we wouldn't tell nobody else to take.
That's right.
Isn't that something? So, what advice would you give a friend is the reason why we're not. Now, listen, we got two other parts to get to. I'm trying to keep my eye on the clock. Last time I was running late. Kim, my timer. But we got a little bit more time here. So I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to talk about the quote of the day. Kimberly moving into the next segment. She has a quote for us, and we'd like to try to give a word out for today. Go ahead, Kim.
Okay, so this show is about making decisions, and the quote I've chosen for today is, sometimes you make the right decision, and sometimes you make the decision right. And that's from Phil McGraw. A lot of times we'll make a decision. If it's a good decision, it's a good decision. But sometimes we don't always make good decisions. We have to be good with the decision that we make, because we can go back and make corrections. If you can't make corrections, you have to get into your mind that it's okay. I made the decision based on the information that I had. Remember, you talked about number one thing before you make a decision. Mm-hmm. You need to have all of the information and realize that there's probably more than two answers. I'll give a quick example. Correct. I remember Mackenzie was had to make a choice between going to her volleyball practice or going to a required practice for her play. And she was stuck on, there's just two options. Either I miss volleyball practice or either I miss the play. And I'm like, Mackenzie, just think outside the box. There's a compromise that can be made here. And it just took me forever to get her to realize that. And I think we have to realize, we have to think outside of the box. There's usually more than just two options. And we came up with something like, okay, well, ask if you can be a little late to this. That way you can make the crucial part of this and then go on to your volleyball practice or whatever you need to do. So just make sure that you know that there are a couple of options. And the other one is, what would you give a friend? What advice? I'm just recapping here.
Yeah.
What advice would you give a friend? Because that removes you from the situation to look at it objectively. Our quote of the day, sometimes you make the right decision. Sometimes you make the decision right.
Oh, I feel like that.
I do too.
I like that. I feel that right there. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Yeah. And the example was excellent.
All right, missionary. all right. Well, let's move on to question number three. I think we're getting where I want to be now. And folks, I'm going to tell you that these questions are not, some folks don't think in this order. I don't necessarily think in this order, but I hope to go through all four of these questions before making my decision, because I tend to think my question number three is something I think about first. And that is, and I'm sure we're going to have some examples of this, what are my values and what do they say to me now concerning this decision? What are my values? We talked last week about faith, family, and finances. We talked about the fact that if you keep your priorities straight and you let things in or you keep them out of your life based on those priorities, then you're just setting yourself up for a good future, young man, young woman. So what are my values and what do they say to me now concerning this situation? Values act as a compass for us, right? We should always refer back to our values. Before making any big decisions, make sure you're clear on what matters most to you, right? And then know what you will and will not do. What you will, and a lot of folks say, well, you know, I will.
Yeah.
I will do some things, but know what you won't do. I'm just going to say it like this, right? Know what you won't do. And you may arrive at a decision that isn't the easiest path, but you can be sure it aligns with your values. I got to give you an example based in my practice. I had a situation where we settled a lawsuit, and there was money that was supposed to go to some children that apparently the at least one child didn't have any contact with her father. And so there was money, though. She was listed. We listed them all. She was listed. And there was some money that was supposed to go to her. And we tried a couple different ways to make contact with this person to get this money to her. And I took some advice from, I asked another lawyer, what should I do about not being able to get this money to this young lady? And the advice I got from that lawyer didn't square up with my values.
Mm-hmm.
He pretty much told me I'd done everything that I, do, just let the money sit there. And, and when I got ready to wind down my business, the money would be there. Well, anybody know anything about me? First of all, I'm not a thief. Secondly of all, I just didn't square up with my values, mm-hmm. right? I didn't believe that that was the right way to handle it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I set off to go to Tupelo, Mississippi on foot and flying in and get to Tupelo, Mississippi. No, I flew in to, was it Tupelo? Is it Mississippi? Yeah, Mississippi.
Yeah, it was Mississippi.
Mm-hmm. And to find this woman, because mm-hmm. I just had to get this money to her because it was the right thing to do. And it wasn't as hard as I thought it was. And I always believe that's because God knows when we're setting off to do right things. And when we set off to do right things, you take one step, he's going to take two. And I can't tell y'all, I've won a lot of big cases in my life. I think sons get tested. I won a lot of big cases. But I've never been more happy, than when I handed this young lady the check. And trust me, when she met up with me, she was driving a hoopty and she was probably killing every mosquito in a square mile of her car.
Oh, my goodness.
You understand what I'm saying? Those of y'all that's from the country, y'all know when the little truck used to come by and kill the mosquitoes. Probably they stopped that. Probably it's causing all kind of cancer or whatever. I don't know. But, she was killing. I mean, her car was smoking and it was making a lot of noise and everything. And when she finally was able to convince that it was real, I couldn't breathe after she gripped me so tight. And then I spent probably another few hours trying to make sure that she got it in a safe place, got the money in a safe place, helped her set up an account, talked to her about how people are going to be coming out of the woodwork, mm-hmm. all this stuff. And it was one of the most fulfilling, satisfying days of practicing law for me.
Wow.
I contrast that with what I would be feeling like right now today had I not done what I did. And so make sure, I'm going back to make sure, because a little voice, a lot of people say, a little voice was telling me this, that, or the other.
Mm-hmm.
You ever had a time when I think you alluded to it earlier, you said, man, something said, don't make that choice.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I believe that something is, the universe is God, whatever yes. you want to call it, mm-hmm. Allah,
yeah, it's Buddhism,
right? Whatever you, it's something bigger than us yes. that's helping to guide us. Kim, you ever had a situation where you was asked to do something? Let's just say, or you had a decision to make, and on the surface it maybe seemed okay or whatever, but when you took a look at your choices, your values, you decided that that I can't make that choice.
Well, I don't think I've had someone say, hey, would you do this? And I felt like, I don't think anybody has asked me to do anything untoward. Mm-hmm. So, but I do a little acting on the side for different things. And sometimes jobs will come across like, oh, that looks great. Oh, that pays great. Let me take a look at it. Then I get to reading in there, the fine print and everything. Oh, no, I don't think I want to be anything that promotes this mm-hmm. or that. And so I just self-adjust and say, I will not be auditioning for that particular role because it doesn't align with my values. So one thing I was thinking about, we talk about people have different varying degrees of values. They're different types. And when we talk mm-hmm. about young people sometimes and maybe the decisions that they make maybe based on values that were passed down to them that may not be conducive to making good decisions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very good point.
Yeah. So people have to be self-aware enough. If you're a young person, self-aware enough to know, hey, maybe my value system is causing me not to make the best decisions. Oh. What do they do in that case? First of all, they have to be self-aware in order to realize that. Mm-hmm. But if they're able to realize that, what should they do based on needing to have a value system that will allow them to make good decisions?
You know, when folks talk to me about that question in a number of different ways, I say this. I just truly believe, and I don't have any science to quantify it or to prove it, but I don't want to push my belief off on anybody out here in radio land, but I believe in God, and I believe that we all have some sort of moral compass. Mm-hmm. I believe it's necessary in order for us to be able to function, in order for us to connect with our being, in order for us to live a prosperous and fruitful and fulfilled life. I haven't met anybody in my practice where they've done something wrong that said to me, oh, I didn't know killing some people was wrong, or I didn't know that selling meth was wrong, or I didn't know that I didn't have no idea, and it didn't bother me not now. But no, we kind of numb ourselves to these things. I can do it when I've numbed myself. I'm getting a little bit off track now, but I will tell you something. My mama used to say, reason why she was so hard on lying is she believed in the progression of sins, right? Mm-hmm. She would say this all the time. If you lie, you'll steal. If you steal, you'll kill.
Wow.
And I'm like, dang, mama comes from stealing and killing. But that was her belief that what happens is just a little bit over time. One little story I'm going to tell you. With me and my brother wanted to go see a movie. Right. Mm-hmm. And we want to go see a movie, and we knew it had a cuss word in it. We knew it had one cuss word in it. I think I was 13 and he was 11. But boy, it was a karate movie. We want to go see the movie. And our mom said we could see it. We could see it. And I was like, oh, great. But then I don't know she said the Holy Spirit told her to ask this question. Y'all old folk didn't know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And she said, mom want to know. Did y'all know anybody that's done seen the movie? Oh, yeah. And she knows she trickles up. She asks the question, was there any bad language in that movie? And when we paused,
she knew.
She knew, right? Okay, so this is the point I'm getting to. And she said, oh, no, I don't want y'all to go see that movie. Me and my brother, boy, we was fit to be tied. But you know, we didn't stomp off. We didn't suck no teeth. You didn't do that.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We just quietly went on upstairs and went to sulking, right? My mama knew we was disappointed. I'm going to try to shut this out real quick. So what she did was she started baking some cookies.
Mm. Mm.
And we said, smell them cookies. You smell those cookies. And we ran downstairs after we knew the cookies ought to be done to get some cookies. And there was a plate full of cookies. And you know, I like oatmeal raisin. What you like, son?
Oatmeal raisin.
Oh, I like
oatmeal raisin. I love oatmeal raisin.
You know, I like oatmeal raisin. Mm-hmm. My brother liked chocolate chip. Mm. Anyway, she had a plate full of cookies. And she said, y'all want some cookies? And we like, yeah. Mm-hmm. Right? When we went to go eat the cookies, she said, hold on. There's one thing I want y'all to know. Is that they're just a little bit of boo-boo in those cookies.
Your mama.
No, she did not.
Just a little bit. See, because we were saying, oh, mom, just a little bit of cuss word at the movie. Just a little bit of cuss word in the movie. Just a little bit of boo-boo in them cookies. So me and my brother I think my brother was halfway trying to figure out, enough?
Will it just go around to
Will I be able to sit? No. And so she said, what's wrong? Y'all don't want to know. I'm like, I don't want, right? after we looked and back and forth and the point sink in, she said, there's nothing wrong with those cookies. But see, even if it was just a little bitty boo-boo in it, you would have wanted, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. That's the same. And she told us that's the same thing you have to, that's how vigilant you have to be about your ear gate, your eye gate. Same vigilance you have about your mouth gate. You don't want no mess going in there. You don't need no mess going in here. Mm-hmm. You don't want no mess going in there. Right. So, very good value builder. Mm-hmm. So anyway, yes. So
that reminds me of the, and I don't know if it's a quote about surrounding yourself with mm-hmm. people. Mm-hmm. You are the five people that you hang around with the most, and that plays into that because what they do, how they think, mm-hmm. all those things become what you are, even though you may think it doesn't affect you, but it will.
Mm-hmm. I want to comment, man. I got a friend of mine that I played basketball with back in college is on Dr. Carlos Artis. And he says, he's commented on the feed and he says, you have to understand, I agree with him totally on this. You have to understand your decisions shape your destiny, and this involves your values, morals, etc. Wow. And yeah, this is my good buddy. He went on to become a OBGYN out of Coker College and the University of North Carolina. And shouts outs to you. I'm very, very proud of him. Yeah, very proud of him. And, you know, I will tell you this: this guy, and this goes along with what we're saying. When I came, this guy and Kenny Nance, who's a State Farm agent on his own agency, let's see here, Russell Manley, who's a pharmacist. These are all the guys I come in with. We've got a police officer, a bunch of business owners from my class, all right?
Mm-hmm. Wow.
These guys set up a study group. And as a young man, you're talking about good, the good. Peer pressure,
right?
Wow. There was a great amount of peer pressure to, after we finished practicing, come let's study. Okay. Wow. And I thought that was one of the most beautiful things. But anyway, Carlos, it's so good to see you, Dr. Artist. And
all right.
Also have on a little shout out to Sylvia Pons. One of my, she was a surrogate mother for me for a while. Y'all, if y'all knew anything about my story, I'm gonna get into it at some point. When I finally had to say stump out of my house, I had to live with Miss Pons for a while and her family. Yes, that's another story. My wife,
oh, wow.
I don't know about all that.
Yeah.
But we're going to get in that one day. But the values and what do they say to me now? Love you, Miss Pons. Key point number four. We're going to move on to key point number four. And here's a question you have to ask yourself, because we all, you know, tell me what you think about when you think about biases. Asansore, what do you think about when you think about biases before I read this question?
Biases. It's something that's, oh, what's the right word? Like I'm a decision, but I'm a little slanted about it because I want to do it more so than the right decision. I have a bias against the right decision.
Okay.
Because I want to do what feels good to me.
Okay. Right. Okay. Yeah. All right. So what about you, Kim? What do you think about when you think about bias?
Well, I think we all have a set of opinions that we have about X, Y, Z. And sometimes those opinions are based purely on surface level things.
Mm-hmm.
And we may have a strong opinion that may have come from our childhood where we believe bananas are blue and you can't tell mm-hmm. me any other way.
Mm-hmm.
And why it's so important is that if you have those type of biases, you've already made your mind up about something mm-hmm. and don't have your eyes open to see what it actually is or what it could be,
right.
You're going to find what you're looking for. If you're looking for a blue banana, you're going to find some kind of way to see blue in that banana. And I think it's not a good thing because you will make an incorrect decision based on your biases because you're looking at a set of facts in a whole nother way.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be your set of facts and not what actually is because of the biases that you have that is a certain way.
Okay, well, I like what you guys are saying. My question for number four is, in order for us to make a good objective decision about the decisions we need to make in our life, one of the things we have to do is to be aware of the biases that might be at play. You know, and I like what you said, Sansari, when you talked about I'm slanted one way or the other.
Yeah.
Right. I have a bias toward my children. You know, you can't really just come to me and tell me a whole lot of stuff about these of mine, because I'm gonna be biased toward my family. I'm gonna be biased toward my friends. I'm gonna have a bias,
right?
About what I believe. You know, right now, golly, what we're getting ready to really have this Republican Democrat thing. I wish we could really. And one side is slanted toward their beliefs. The other side is slanted toward their belief, and the two shall never meet in the middle. So I don't know. But anyway, there is one particular bias that's particularly dangerous, though, particularly dangerous, and that's confirmation bias. Now, I believe you were about to talk about it, Sansari. I deal with it a lot in my profession. I'll give you an example. I had a case where a woman reported she had been strangled. All right. There was a video tape that showed no strangulation whatsoever. But the cop said, well, that doesn't mean that she got strangled while she was on video. Okay. The woman had no marks whatsoever on her neck. And the cop said, well, that's just indication that she had recently been strangled, because it takes a while for the neck to bruise.
Really?
And when I tell y'all, when we went through this testimony, and I had already talked to the jury in voir dire about confirmation bias. See, what the cop was seeing, and I don't mean just to pick on cops, but what the cop was seeing was anything that could help him explain what makes the woman's statement true. Right? And so what happens is, when you have confirmation bias, you only see what supports it and you reject what doesn't support it. So back to that example we was talking about in relationships, if I believe the person loved me, I can't see the fact I got three black eyes and a big old knot on my head. No, he just had a bad day.
Well, it was my fault.
I can't see that he don't get up and go to work and support us and everything and all that. Oh, his family and life is just against him. And you know, white folks don't like black folks. If I heard that, let me stop, because I'm getting because I have a confirmation bias. Nice. That means that the things that I want to believe is true, I'm going to see the information that supports it. We're going to see what it is we believe. So my a mentor of mine, when I first started doing this work, said to me, she says, things are not the way we see them, right? Our reality is our perception, but that's not really what it is. We see things because we see things the way that we are, not the way that they are. I got to tell y'all a quick little story shared with me by that same, my mentor in the legal business. He says, Mike, there was a guy that was leaving the village, and he was leaving the village because the village, he got into it with everybody there. They was just not friendly, and there was just, you know, there was just a bad village. So he was going to walk to another village. And so he walked to the village, and he met an old man on the side of the road. And he asked the old man, he says, is that a good village that I'm going to? What are the people like? And the old man says, are you coming from a good village? And what are the people like back there? And he says, no, I'm not coming from a good village. And the people back there, I got into it with all of them. They're always talking about each other, blah, 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 blah. The old man said, well, you'll find the same thing in the village you're going to now. Well, another young man came through and asked the old man, he said, how are the people down there in that village? Same village. And the old man said, how was the people in the village you just left? He said, well, they was warm and kind, friendly. I really hated to have to leave, but I'm on my way, such and such and such. And I just So, but I'm going to be staying down there for a while. He said, well, you'll find the same thing down there.
Whoa.
The moral of that story is basically it's what we see. It's perception is reality for us. If we believe people are kind and helpful and whatnot, that's what they'll be for us. If we don't believe it, that's not what they're going to be for us. Got a little bit off topic, but the trick for biases is knowing which bias is in play, and don't let that be the thing that makes you make the wrong decision. Don't let that be the thing that makes you make the wrong decision. Kimberly, this point, we were supposed to be talking a little bit to a guest that we were so hopeful to have here. And I was so hopeful that he could share his testimony with you. But because he's not here and unable to share his testimony, I got to tell y'all, let me give y'all a little bit of the background. Today, on the northern side of Tulsa, we had a major power outage. Even our restaurant was shut down for a while.
Till 2 o'clock. We didn't open till 2.
Oh, till 2?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We had to go get the baby from school because the school power shut down. The airport was shut down, right? Okay. Yeah, they had the airport shortage. So our guest is a barber and a businessman, and he had folks that was on appointments and whatnot, and when the power came back on, he had to shift everything, so he's not here. But and boy, I tell you, he was going to share with you all his testimony. He's got a great testimony. Wow. Every time I talk to him, I get like goosebumps. But he's gonna be here next week to talk to us a little bit about his testimony. And it's a testimony of triumph. That's all I'm going to tell you. I will tell you a little bit more. This young man, if you ever saw the movie, Earth, what was the movie with, Denzel Washington? He was a boxer. Hurricane. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hurricane. Mm-hmm. This is Tulsa's Hurricane. Okay. Mm, that's all I'm going to say. You're going to want to hear this story next week. But it's his story. I want to remind you all that it is his story, young man, young woman. He's only telling it so that you can know that you too, and I promise you, when you hear what this cat's been through, if you think you're going through something, okay, maybe you might want to rethink that.
Hmm.
He went through this, and now he has triumphed. But like I said, I don't want to steal his thunder, but he is an amazing brother. So we're going to have him on next week. We're wanting to talk a little bit. So in his place, in his stead, I want you guys to share a little bit about your background. I know we didn't get a chance to talk much about, I think they've heard a lot from me about where I come from and all that kind of stuff. What'd you say, Kim?
Oh, I was going to say, they're supposed to. It's your show. It's not my show.
Well, I've been getting it in. But Sasa Ray, I know you're a native of Tulsa, right?
No.
And we're going to wrap it up. I mean, when I said not a native, thank you so much.
Yeah. Now I consider myself now.
My bias.
Yeah, your bias.
Put you as a native of Tulsa. But I know that you have lived here in Tulsa for a long while, right?
Yes, I have. I consider myself a Tulsan.
Okay. But you're from San Diego, right? Or that area.
Born and raised.
Right. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Tell us a little bit about your childhood. And the reason why we're doing this, I want folks to know this. The reason why we're doing this is because we want you to know that let me just start with this and tell you that Sunsway has been working Manning Law Firm. She's number one legal assistant. My right-hand lady has gone through, and she's great on her job. She knows what she's doing. And she's gone through a few things, right?
Mm-hmm.
And she was a radio personality.
Yes.
But before that, she's had some trials and tribulations that make her who she is today. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to. I want to inspire a young person that may be going through something at this time to know that this isn't the end. This is not even. You're not even halfway through the book.
You can write the chapters. That's right.
Share a little bit with us.
Well, and I'm glad you asked that, because a lot of it that creates the person who we are is from the time we're born to the time we leave. My childhood growing up in San Diego, first let me say this. It was in one household. It was me, my brother, my mom, my dad, my Uncle Raybug, and my grandmother. We all stayed in the same house, same little 3-bedroom house. Going to school, you know, I went through elementary school. I remember walking, you know, by myself. You could do it back then, mm-hmm. by myself. Mm-hmm. Then going through, let me just say this. Mm-hmm. My dad started working, driving trucks. You know, he started out with Mayflower. I don't know if you still remember that.
Yes, yes.
So he was gone. So that happened when I was like about 7, between 7 and 8 years old. So from that time, I was kind of shifted from family to family to family to family, because my mom and dad had broke up when I was 4 years old.
Okay.
Mama Dot, she had a stroke and ended up going to a individual care. And then we come home one day. I'm 9 years old. Come home one day. She's sitting on the porch. She didn't sign herself out. So that meant for me to have, I had no childhood that period. Here I am, 9 years old, taking care of my grandmother, feeding her, doing her hair, bathing her, doing everything. And then I guess the family got together and they were like, you know, it's just grandma, dad, and that time my brother. Well, she's not good. I was at home most of the time by myself. So finally it came up where, well, no, we're going to shift up to L.A. I'm saying all that to say this. I had so many different environments around me, but the one thing that saved me was my aunt and my Uncle Raybug. They were like, no, we taking her down back from L.A. where I was staying with my Auntie Bert, who's, you know, that was my favorite auntie, though, but she was the Bobby Blue Bland going to the parties type thing. So I came back home, and from the time I was like 10, I was in a good situation, in a place every day.
Let me ask you this. While you were getting bounced around, right? While you're getting bounced around and going through things, and what do you believe helped you to know that things are going to change? Did you believe that? Did you believe that one day things would change? Because I know, and I'm sorry, I didn't mean to put you on the spot, that we got limited time.
Yeah, we got limited time.
Did you know that one day, or were you being told that one day? What gave you faith to keep going, to not run away from the house, just to keep going?
I'm a little embarrassed to say this, but while I was staying with my Uncle Bill and my Aunt Mickey and my 3 cousins, Punkin and Sharon and Shirley, because I never got that incentive from anyone. Things are going to be all right. They just put me there.
Right.
And then my cousins had an attitude toward me, and because you know how it is in most, well, my black household. I'm light-skinned, they're real dark-skinned, so they were like, oh, you think you this, you that, and I didn't. I've never thought of myself as being above or superior to anyone, and at that time, I had a broken leg, so they really, really teased me. But what saved me, it's so embarrassing, was I caught outside a little white and a little gray mouse, and my Uncle Bill bought me a cage and helped me. In there, and I would sit. That was my consolation. I would sit in there and just admire those little, watch them play and hold them, pick them up, and everything. And that was a solace to me because it took me away from all that. It took me away from all that, and it kind of gave me, you know, it's crazy, but they kind of gave me the confidence that I can take care of myself and I can take care of somebody else, which okay. I ended up doing. Right. But just going from all those households, it just really it just kind of makes you feel
too silly.
No.
I thought about Ben too when you
did you is that what she did?
You had a Ben.
I had a Ben. I did have a Ben. That saved me. But as I got older, and then, you know, a lot of responsibility was put on me when I did finally move in with my aunt and my uncle. I had my 2 cousins who I call my sisters, because we basically grew up together.
Right.
And from the time I was like 10 and a half, 11 years old, I was taking care of them, because my auntie, who I call Ma, my auntie, she was either working or in school. Mm-hmm. And my Uncle Raybug, he was working, and he wasn't one of those dads that say, hey, you know, come on, we're going to go do this. The only thing we do is on Sundays, everybody would get dressed up, go to Calvary mm-hmm. Baptist Church. After Calvary Baptist Church, we went to L.A.
I was going to ask you, so you were in the church.
Very sporadic.
Don't.
And that saved
don't
me
minimize
too.
It now.
Yeah, that saved me
don't
too.
Don't minimize it, because I'm a firm believer that, but that the lack of that component, which was a very like an automatic thing in our community, that being missing has caused a lot of stuff. But anyway, sons, we're gonna give you a chance to tell your whole story.
I have my Native American influence too.
I know you
from
got
my grandfather.
That, yeah. So, sons, I certainly appreciate that. Let me ask both of y'all this question. We're going to move on. First of all, just to recap, just in four questions. We went over the questions. Question number one is there a third option? Question number
or
two.
Or fourth or fifth.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What advice would you give a friend? One thing you want to ask yourself before
take
you make a big
decision. Out of the situation, mm-hmm. yeah.
What are my values and what do they say to me now concerning this, right?
Do I do the easy thing or the right thing?
And then finally, what decision-making biases might be at play here? Mm-hmm. Those are the four questions. Now, I want to ask each of you, and you could chime in like you like, or however you like. Can you tell us one bad decision you made?
Yes. And went to the casino and I lost my money. I ain't going to lie. And it was my boss, Miss Smith, said, see,
oh,
and
wow.
told you, don't do that.
Okay. All right. Kim,
can
you share with us?
That was a long time ago, Mr. Manning.
As you wish.
I've made a lot of bad decisions in my life. Mm-hmm. I have. So many that I can't even think of one. But what I do want to say about that is making bad decisions. You know how people say, hey, I have no regrets in life. I don't regret anything.
Yeah.
Right. Well, you know, there are always things that we would wish that we may have done differently. But the way you can live, this is just my thought process, the way you can live with no regrets, because there's no way you haven't done anything that you felt was a bad decision. The way you can live with no regrets is to learn something from those bad decisions. Mm. I remember listening to a speech once and the guy said, well, you either win or you learn. So if you can learn from every bad decision that you've made, you can live life with no regrets, because you can find something about that bad decision that prompted you to be better, to make better decisions in the future. So again, I'm not sharing any personal bad decisions on my part right now. But I think that is something to live by. Always learn from those bad decisions.
Yeah, I sure did.
Right. I'm not gonna name no names, but I know about a woman that was in a car like her freshman year in college, and they was passing around a doobie, and that's probably not a big deal anymore now since everybody's smoking marijuana. But this person, instead of not receiving the joint, she put the joint to her lips and she pulled a Bill Clinton. I guess that's what they call it. She says she didn't exhale. Now, I'm not going to say no names or nothing like that. But she felt like that was not a good decision on her part, because then she had to talk about it. Or she felt she had
she
to tell the military.
She had
to tell the post office about it because they asked her, have you ever done drugs?
Right.
I'm like, she should roll on there. I never exhale.
Never inhale.
Never inhale. That's what it was.
Not said nothing.
So I don't know naming the names about that bad person.
Right. Let me put this on me so I can roll my eyes.
So you can roll your eyes.
Lord
have mercy. All right. So listen, life is full of decisions. Being able to think strategically before making big decisions can help you in your career and life.
Yeah.
Think through the questions that we talked about. Because we're finally getting it wrapped up. I wanted to scan through my deal and see if I saw anybody that wanted to. But think through the decision, the questions above to help to ensure that you arrive to the best outcome.
Mm-hmm. And can I say, don't overthink.
Don't overthink.
You think that's a good one? Don't overthink the situation.
That's where that analysis paralysis comes in. Right. You have so many things to analyze that you can't really do what you need to do or make the decision.
Right. Okay. Well, you know, I always get a little bit awkward. I'm going to tell y'all that Radio Land. I always get a little bit awkward at this time because I don't know exactly how much time I got left to say what we need to say in order to shut the show out. But I'm going to get better at this. I really am. So anyway, where am I at on the time? I'm sorry.
It is 4:59.
Absolutely. I see it. All right. It's been my pleasure. Once again, a shout out to Bobby. We're on KBOB 89.9 FM. Mr. Bobby Eaton and made it all happen. Also, this weekend, on April the 6th, Saturday, April the 6th, the Eaton Out Band is going to be performing at the 36th Street North Event Center at 7 p.m. A grown and sexy party.
Get your tickets now.
Yes, you need to get it right now. And this Friday at Booker T. Washington High School, my very own daughter is going to be playing Paulette the play The Legally Blonde. This child is something else. She never ceases to amaze me. She will be Miss Paulette. That y'all that know that she's the hairdresser. She's going to be the hairdresser. But anyway, this has been In the Know, a show dedicated to the development of young people. And I am just so excited to be God's vessel in this.
Yes.
And we're going to get better for y'all. I promise you. We're coming with some new and exciting content. And y'all pray for us. And if you got something that you think that we should be talking about that's going to help to develop these young people, go ahead and give us a shout out. Okay? We love you. Take care.
Bye-bye.
As we wrap up another insightful episode of In the Know, remember that the journey to success is a collective effort. Share the wisdom, spread the knowledge, and let's build a legacy together. Join us next time for more invaluable insights that empower, inform, and inspire.